Deepti Kalaran joins me on the set to take a look at what the front pages are saying today. Hi, Deepti.
Hi, Ginny.
A lot of the papers are focusing on Remembrance Day commemorations that were held around the world on Sunday.
That's right. Some very poignant front pages from the British papers in particular. Let's show you the British tabloid Daily Mirror that's going with a picture of an army vet at the Armed Forces Memorial in Britain yesterday. For your tomorrow, they gave their today. Very, very poignant headline there. There's also on the front page of The Independent an incredible sand portrait. In fact, it's one of many sand portraits of different soldiers killed in action. This one here is that of Wilfred Owen. He was one of the most well-known poets of the First World War and killed in action. It's actually this sand art project is part of filmmaker Danny Boyle's art project.
That's so impressive. All right, let's come back to Paris. So we're many world leaders, about 60 of them, gathered here for a service that actually ended up being quite political.
Political in particular because of Emmanuel Macron's speech and in particular his thinly veiled jibes, we might say, at Donald Trump and Vladimir Putin. It was an Armistice Day rebuke to Trump, so says the Financial Times on its front page, noting that Macron attacked nationalism and said it betrayed patriotism. Now, the Washington Times, a conservative U.S. publication, really gives us a different point of view. They hailed Donald Trump's restraint in weathering a, quote, imperious lecture from Macron and dodging an anti-Trump demonstration. For them, the service was rife, with a complex symbolism and diplomatic pitfalls. But through it all, they say Donald Trump went out on a high note by refusing to let Macron's barbs affect him and his tribute. Indeed, his tribute was also overshadowed by one visit that he did not make, that to the American military ceremony and memorial in the city of Belleau, northeast of Paris, allegedly due to weather. John Kerry and Winston Churchill's grandson were among the critics, as well as this cartoonist, Moreland. You see here a dead Marine saying, lest he get wet, the president decided not to come.
In Ireland now, Deepti, an inquest begins today into the Ballymurphy massacre of 1971.
This massacre took place in the small neighborhood in West Belfast in 1971. That was a year before the Bloody Sunday massacre. We had 10 unarmed people who were shot dead by British soldiers, including a mother of 8 who was shot in the face and a Catholic priest who was shot while performing last rites to a dying man. The British Army had moved into Republican strongholds at the time to arrest IRA suspects after the introduction of controversial legislation allowing internment without trial. The British Army say those who were gunned down were armed terrorists. The families say they were innocent protesters. And after 47 years of campaigning, an inquest will begin today.
Something different now. A controversial idea by British businesses is to microchip their workers to protect company data.
Supposedly to protect company data. It's actually a Swedish company called Biohacks that's providing the technology. They're in talks with British legal and financial firms to microchip their staff. The chips are about the size of a grain of rice, that's what the Daily Mail says, and would allow the companies to restrict who can access sensitive documents and information. There's a really eerie quote from this article. Let me quote here. There's no dropping it nor forgetting it. There's always going to be an ultimate backup with these microchips. Around 4,000 people in Sweden are microchipped right now, including dozens of workers at a travel company. Nonetheless, the idea has sparked backlash for a whole host of reasons. Privacy, independence, control of the human body, ethics. I mean, the list can go on and on.
Certainly can. All right, next. The Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation, or APEC, summit gets underway this week in the Pacific island of Papua New Guinea.
And it's the first time that PNG is hosting this summit. It's the poorest of the 21 countries who will be attending. And the summit was overshadowed somewhat by what The Guardian calls Maserati Gate last month, when it was revealed that the government splurged out on 40 Maseratis and 3 Bentleys for the summit, despite high levels of poverty in the country. Something to look out for at this summit will be China and China's growing influence in the region. The summit will actually take place in a convention center that was paid for with Chinese money, something that regional players like Australia are increasingly worried about. That's growing Chinese influence in the region. Nonetheless, in Papua New Guinea, there's a lot of expectations. The local paper Post Courier there calls it the, quote, opportunity of a lifetime that will allow PNG to rejuvenate its tired old ways of approaching development.
Titi, just to wrap up now, yachtsmen taking part in the transatlantic race, the Route du Rhum, have been imparting some of their realities to the world on social media.
That's right. The Route du Rhum already has its two winners, but the other skippers are still arriving. It's a transatlantic solo yacht race, for those who don't know what it is, taking place every 4 years that see competitors sail from Brittany in western France to Pointe-à-Pitre in the French Caribbean island of Guadeloupe. That's a lot of time spent at sea. So some skippers have been sharing their daily lives, in particular what they eat, Jeannie. And as the Huffington Post says, whatever you ate on Sunday was infinitely better than what these guys are eating. Let's take a look. Not very appetizing. That is scrambled eggs and cheese in a packet powder form. There's another sailor that was eating a banana, which actually doesn't sound that bad compared to that packet powder thing. There was a small fish as well. And the last picture, I don't even know what's in that packet, but it definitely does not look very appetizing. Some sort of food in powder form again.
All right. Makes my heart already bad enough to sail around the world by yourself. And then if you have to eat that, it's not my cup of tea. But thank you, Deepti, for sharing that with us. Deepti Kaloran there with a look at what the press review has for us today. And don't forget, you can get a closer look at that press review on our website. That address is France24.com. Coming up in the next half hour,